in the book. One talks about the four types of resistance in meetings and such. Would you walk us through those? They are called disagreement with purpose, emotional fear of personal impact, not enough information, and the wrong leader. Spend a couple seconds on each of those, if you will.
Sure enough. I think, first of all, we need to understand that resistance is a very natural response to change. And because change brings about uncertainty and ambiguity, and while we might be excited about stepping into a change, we also know, almost viscerally, that we don't know exactly how it's going to turn out. So particularly when there is a change that is somebody hasn't chosen, and they're confronted with, resistance becomes even higher, and therefore it's really important to work with this. So when resistance shows up, when they don't have enough information actually about what's going on, they don't understand enough, or not enough information is being communicated. So, or they experience the change as being out of context of what they are seeing is going on. The second one is about they are becoming emotionally challenged by the change, which means something is at stake for them. There's usually some kind of letting go of the old before we can actually change to welcome the new. And often at the beginning of change, it's not very clear what it is that we might need to let go of. So therefore, there is some emotional reluctancy or concern. And so actually, the right strategy to address that is to, particularly when we do large organizational change, is to involve stakeholders in understanding what the change is about and sharing their concerns about it, but also then tapping into their vision of what the change could be and sort of transforming their reluctance into actually buying into what the change can create. And then there is the third one, which is the wrong leader, we say. So the leader plays a very important role as being the advocate of the change, as the one who will bring the new change about. If that leader has failed, so to speak, before, or there is a sense of not being able to trust the leader, that needs to be somehow addressed, either directly and openly, or sometimes leaders have to be replaced because they just don't gain the support of the stakeholders to move the change through. And then finally, we might just simply disagree with what the purpose is of the change, and we have a different perspective on it. And so that's then the opportunity for creating dialogue. So what does the change really need to be? And often when we're at the beginning of a change process, we have an initial understanding of the change. We might even have some glimpses of what the change might look like in the end, but we can't really know for sure. And so I think the best way to work with all of these kinds of resistance is to create what we call a high engagement process, where we involve the stakeholders around, what is at stake for them, really understanding what they might lose, but also what they can contribute to it. So it's like it's getting their buy-in. It's getting them energetically enrolled in this process. Mm-hmm. And that's one of the most important tasks. In the end, I think it's important to understand that a change lives in the people. That doesn't live in the technical processes outside. In the end, it's the people who need to enact the change. Therefore, it is important to enroll them. And it's also important to know at what point in time you enroll and you include what stakeholders. I mean, change is a process that has many steps to it. So thinking through all of those aspects is an important change leadership skill that needs to be cultivated. And this, I would just like to say one more thing, is that even a leader who is already clear that a change is needed, he or she may still undergo all of the same experiences of sense of being scared, of ambiguity and loss, and needs to work that through themselves and kind of actually model to the rest of the organization how to do it well.